Okay, I wanted to go back and talk about number systems briefly. So I'm calling this number systems part two. In the first number systems lecture I did, we talked about binary and we talked about base 16. What I want to do is go back, kind of talk about the topics again, and maybe refresh your memory as how we go through. So another popular language in computing is base 8. I have to apologize, not the neatest thing in the world, but this is often referred to as octal. Oct being 8. Now, I always usually go off on a tangent and say, because October is the 8th month, right? Well, originally, I'll spare you the big long story. Originally, there were 10 months because we have 10 fingers, and they were not called month 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Month 10 was December. Month 9 was November. Month 8 was October. And then January and February were added later, but I'll save you that. So, anytime we talk about a new base, the first thing I ask you is the number of digits in this base. So, and the answer is always the base. So since we're working in base 8, the answer to this question is 8. And then I always turn around anytime we're talking about a new one and say, okay, what are those digits? And the digits are 0 to 1 less than the base. So the only digits we have are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. With that being said, I will clear this and we will do an example. So I might, for example, ask you, what is 700, or more accurately, 743 in base 8 equals what in base 10? Because it looks like 743, but it's really 7 followed by 4 followed by 3. So the first thing we need to do is we need to go through and figure out the weights for each of these digits. And the way we do that is by taking the base and raising it to subsequent powers. So anything to the first power is 1, anything to the first power is itself, and then 8 squared is 64. And if we went and had 8 to the third, that would be, I believe, 512. So those are the weights. So, if I'm in class, I tell the students, okay, tell me how many 64s there are. Well, there's 7 of those. And then I will ask, tell me how many 8s there are. And they'll tell me 4. And then I'll say, okay, how many 1s are there? And they should tell me 3. So this equals 448 plus 32 plus 3, which should equal 483 base 10. So that's the same process that we went through before, converting from some arbitrary base to base 10. Now then, if we go the other way, I'm going to ask you, if we have 200 base 10, how do we represent that as a base 8 number? So we start with the number, and like I said, I like to use the division method, and we always divide by the base we're going to. So this time, since we're using base 8, we would divide by 8. 200, I usually tell my students I'll do the first one for you, is 25 with a remainder of 0. And then the math gets a little easier. 25 divided by 8 is 3 with a remainder of 1. And then the one that usually gives students the problem is the last one. How many times can we take 8 from 3? None. What do we have left over? The 3 we started with. And now we have hit 0, so we stop the process. We take the remainders in the reverse order they were generated. So 3, 1, 0, base 8 is how we represent the decimal number 200. So that's just another base that we often work in computing. What I want to show you now is something that I refer to as tricks, because a lot of times you need to go between base 2 and base 16 and base 8. So I'll first show you a trick for going from base 2 to base 16. And you can pretty much count on having a question like this on your final. But basically, if I have a big long string, 0010, 0101, 1100, 1001, 1111, 0000, and I will unfortunately have to continue this down here, 1010, and then finally 0101. And I tell you that's a base 2 number. And I would like you to convert it to base 16. Well, I think you will pretty quickly agree that if you had to calculate all the powers of 2 that covered however many digits this is, and then come up with a huge number, and then have to divide that huge number by 16 repeatedly, that, you know, that's going to take you a really, really, really long time. But since 16 equals 2 to the 4th, we have a little trick we can do. We can go through, and starting at the right, we can go through, and every 4 digits we can mark off 4 bits. Then within those 4 bits, since 16 is 2 to the 4th, we go from 0, which is all zeros, to 15, which is 4 ones. So we can go through, and if you go through and convert these, you'll probably get to the point you can just look at these and tell. But I have 2, 5, C, 9, F, 0, A, 5. So, you know, in just a few seconds, I can go through and say that big long binary number, here is the hexadecimal representation. Now, the one thing to note, let's go the other way. I'll erase the whole screen. That'll probably be easier. So if I have 1A5C in base 16, and I want to know what that is in binary, you can kind of do the same thing. Basically, you would take each hexadecimal digit and convert it to its equivalent. Now, the equivalent has to be in 4 bits. So we need to zero pad. So that is what 1 is in 4 bits. This is what A is in 4 bits. This is what 5 is in 4 bits. And this is what C is in 4 bits. So we can go through, and as long as we remember to pad with zeros anywhere we need to make that a 4-bit number, we can very easily convert from base 16 to base 2. Now then, exactly same process. 8 is 2 to the 3rd. So if we have a big long string of numbers like 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, base 2, and we need to convert that to octal, this time we go through and we mark sets of 3 bits, and then we go through and say, okay, this is 2, this is 7, this is 4, this is 0, and this is 3. So 27403 is the octal representation of that binary string. And just to be complete, we'll do base 8 to base 2. So if we have 1, 3, 7, 4, and we know that that's base 8, and like I said, we want to convert it to base 2, how do we do that? Well, we take each of these octal digits and convert it into their 3-bit equivalent, again, because 8 is 2 to the third. So what we do in 3 bits, we have 0, 0, 1, then we have 0, 1, 1, 7 is 1, 1, 1, and 4 is 1, 0, 0. So we went through, and in this case, we had to pad with a 0 there. We had to pad with a couple of zeros there. So it's a very, very important that you remember that you need to pad to the all 4 bits in the case of hexadecimal and all 3 bits in the case of octal. So another example and some tricks that will probably come in handy and benefit you throughout the semester.